Welcome again to the series in mathematics. The purpose of the today lecture will be to see the fundamental theorem of algebra and to explore the architectonic inside-outside distinction from the perspective of the exponential and logarithmic bridges that we have set up between harmonics and geometry. The exponential bridge is a bridge from geometry to harmonics, and the logarithmic bridge is a bridge from harmonics to geometry. This in combination with the differential calculus of both the real and the complex or imaginary domain that we have developed up to now. So let's start from the point where we stopped last time, which involves our notion of quantum space. And the issue is how to consider the real line in quantum space, first of all. This has led us to the universal covering of the circle by the helix, where the circle lies on what we call our epiphania or screen, and the helix is universally unfolding in different stairs above the circle of our screen. The important thing here is that we can think of the covering projection of the helix to the circle in terms of the complex exponential function, basically the extension of the exponential function from the real numbers to the circle, which has now the peculiar property that it is not universally inverted. So, if we want to think of the notion of the logarithm as a complex function from the circle on our screen to the real line in quantum space, which is the helix, we can do it only within specific intervals. And these intervals have some length which, from our perspective, give the notion of quanta, the length of a quantum, which is 2 pi times the imaginary unit j. So in this way, the exponential function valued on the circle is inverted only with respect to distinct branches. So we have the phenomenon of branching here. So we have a well-defined notion of a complex logarithm only within specific branches. This is the effect of the unresolvable kernel that the projection from the real line as a helix to the circle in quantum space has. And as we will see later, this leads us to what we call the universal equation of ciphers, which says basically that the exponential of 2 pi, 2 pi corresponds to a complete rotation, times the imaginary unit, times the winding number, which is an integer, each winding number corresponding to a particular level or scale, integer scale, of this helix, equals the unity. This is our universal equation of ciphers, which we will examine in more detail in the sequel. The other thing to keep in mind is that the helix now, thought of as the real line in quantum space, functions as a partition spectrum where the different blocks of this spectrum are indexed by the integers. Now, if we want to transcribe it in terms of harmonics, what this gives, I mean this helical bridge, it gives the following. We can consider bounded portions of this helix, so we can bound it from above and below. And we can think of a wave, a helical wave, which is traveling along this bounded portion of the helix. And let's consider that we bound it at the second stem. Then this wave is reflected on a bound, for example, a mirror, and we have the inverse or reflected wave traveling back. Now what we get is this phenomenon which is characteristically quantum and we have called self-interference, which gives rise to a standing wave which is characterized by the harmonics. So in this case, since we have two stairs, in this bounded portion, what we get is a resolution spectrum of frequencies corresponding just from two harmonic frequencies. And each quantum, remember that each quantum has length 2 pi j, corresponds now to a harmonic frequency of this standing wave. Now, let's see what the harmonic frequency 2, which corresponds to the winding number 2, says. We have to think in quantum space, as we have already explained, both in terms of position and in terms of velocity or momentum. So, what this says in the harmonic frequency 2, frequency is defined as the number of circulations per unit of time. Let's consider a unit of time, a complete period, which corresponds to one circulation. So this now is qualified as a temporal interval. The harmonic frequency 2 now, what it says is that we travel or we oscillate with double the frequency in comparison to the one which corresponds to the first harmonic. So essentially, imagine that you have as a standard the temporal period 2 pi of a complete circulation. Now, in the first harmonic, you have the ratio 1 to 1. Okay? In the second harmonic, you have the ratio 2 over 1, which is the ratio of the octave. It's a consonant interval in harmonics. It means that we travel in the same time, we travel 2 times the same circle. So our frequency is bigger. So we travel with double velocity in comparison to the first case. So the frequency now pertains to the number of circulations per unit of time. And the same, of course, thinking pertains to all the higher harmonics. So we can consider a standing wave bounded here, where we have the appearance of the third harmonic, and so on. In this way, over each point of the circle, we have a discrete spectrum of the harmonics, of all the harmonics, which is visually invisible, but it depends on the frequency, so the velocity of circulating around the circle. So each point brings with it the whole spectrum of the harmonics depending on the depth of resolution of our helix. Now, what this says? Let's try to think in terms of music. As we circulate around, we can think, after the unfolding of the circle into the helix, as a sequential ordering of different notes, different events on our space. You can see that on the circle, you need to choose a particular orientation, but because of the multivalency now of the angle, on the circle, you cannot sequentially order things. So you need to universally cover the circle by the helix in order to be able to distinguish the different number of circulations in terms of the winding number, and thus to sequentially order the events, which are the notes that we play, for example, in a musical piece. But this is not the whole story, because each now of the points of the circle, so each phase, brings inbuilt within it the whole spectrum of the harmonics. So in this way, we have the sequential ordering of events, which I call the melodic aspect of time in this setting, but we have also implicit and invisible, from the perspective of our screen, the whole harmonic spectrum, which corresponds to the different frequencies or to the different layers, the different scalars, integer scalars of this helix. In this way, we have another vertical type of dimensionality, because it's not a space dimension, which pertains to the harmonics. But what this gives is that events which are not sequentially ordered, or they are very far with respect to their sequential ordering, if we unfold to the helix, they can communicate to each other and they can resonate. This is what communication is in this setting, in terms of the harmonics. So if they bear the same frequency, or their frequencies synchronize together in a hypercycle. So imagine that you have different things which are entering together, so different holes which enter together into what we have called a symphony cycle. And this symphony cycle is a way of coordinating now things having different frequencies. And this is what we get through this construction and the qualification now through the exponential function valued on the circle and the inversion, the local inversion, with respect to distinct branches, which are afterwards, of course, they are glued together in non-singular regions, which is the logarithm function as a function locally defined from the circle to the real line in quantum space. So we want now to employ this very powerful setting to examine the fundamental theorem of algebra and to provide an extremely simple proof of this theorem, which was first proved by Gauss in his PhD thesis, 1799. What it says? It says that every polynomial with complex coefficients, which is non-constant and of degree n, so you go to the nth power, it has precisely n roots, counted, of course, in terms of their multiplicity. So this means now that every polynomial with complex coefficients is solvable in the complex number domain, in the domain of the complex numbers, and the solutions are called the roots of this polynomial equation, and the roots are these complex numbers, which makes the polynomial equation equal to zero. This is what a root is. A polynomial equation now, as of course you know from the real case, involves a complex variable now, z, having complex coefficients. So you have a complex coefficient times z, and you have a sum of all the different powers of z. This defines a polynomial. We can think of a polynomial now as a function from z to p of z, which is the definition of this polynomial. A polynomial also has a constant term, which is also very important in our thinking. We will sketch now the proof of this theorem by abduction, and the method of abduction in this case is based on a very simple instance of what we call a reduction ad absurdum. Okay? So this is the method of abduction, how it works here as a method of logical proof. So how we proceed? So we make a hypothesis, and on the basis of this hypothesis, we form a conclusion which leads to some absurdity. And in this way, the opposite of the hypothesis is true. So how we proceed? We consider a complex number in the Euler representation. So a complex number, we can consider it, we can think of a complex number on the complex plane as characterized by the modulus. Let's take this circle here. The modulus will be the radius r, and of course it will have an angular component which is expressed through the exponential function as a face on the circle. So as we already know, every point on this circle is characterized by the product of the radius times the exponential of the imaginary unit times the angle, where the angle is measured in radians, as we have already explained. Okay, so how we proceed? Let's suppose that there is no root, so there is no complex number such that the value of the polynomial evaluated at this number is never zero. So it is not a root. And let's start from the case, let's consider the two limiting cases. The limiting cases will be, in this case, defined in terms of the radius. So let's consider, first of all, that the radius is zero, or that it tends to zero. Now, in the polynomial, since the radius is zero, what it survives is only the constant term of the polynomial. So the mapping from a complex number through the polynomial, what it will give a single point on the complex plane. Now the single point can be considered as the constant loop. We think of a complex number as a constant loop. Let's go now to the other extreme case. We consider that the radius is extremely large. Since the radius is extremely large, only the biggest power of the polynomial will have the dominant effect. So we can consider that the whole polynomial is dominated by the biggest power. Let's call this power n. Now, the mapping of this circle will be what? It will be a loop, so you can think of this loop as a circle, which, since we have nth power, it winds around the origin of the circle n times. But it never crosses the origin, because our hypothesis is that there is no root. So the image of the circle will be a loop which is winding around the origin n times. But recall now that the winding number is a topological invariant. Now, what this means is that since there is no obstacle, since we have by hypothesis that the root, that there is no root, so the polynomial never gets zero, we can contract continuously the biggest loop corresponding to the R being very large to the constant loop. And this leads to the conclusion now that our polynomial is constant. And through this, this is the reduction ad absurdum. Of course, in the general case, our polynomial is not constant. And in this way, there would be exactly n roots of a polynomial equation of the nth degree. You see now that the power, the nth power, can be thought in terms of the windings. What this shows now, it is very simple abductive proof. What this shows is that algebraically the field, corpus, or body of knowledge expressed in terms of the complex numbers is algebraically closed. So every polynomial equation, for sure, they will have roots in this domain. And the nth power, if the polynomial is of the nth power, there will be exactly nth roots. This is not the case, for example, in the domain of real numbers. As we already know from the simple equation x squared equals minus 1. where we have to consider roots of negative numbers. So in this way, the complex numbers extend the real number domain in the most economic way, such that to achieve the condition of algebraic closure. So every polynomial equation will have precisely n roots, if it is of degree n, expressed in terms of the complex numbers. This now is the way that we will understand what we will call the roots of unity. But before going there, I would like to consider the issue again of orientation. This is extremely important architectonically to grasp what the whole thing is about. So, as we said, the basic characteristic of a circulation is that it can take place in two ways, either clockwise or anticlockwise. Now, in terms of the helix, it means that the helix can unfold either in an anticlockwise way or the mirror image, which is the clockwise way. So we need to consider, from the harmonic perspective, the interference of these two different types of unfolding. And this is what will give what we have called the helical standing wave and the harmonics. So in this way, you can see that if you consider both of them, what you get, what is bounded by this double helix now, it is a helicoid. And this is how we will think of the helicoid in terms of harmonics. So the helicoid, we think of it as a helical standing wave coming from the self interference of the two different types of unfolding corresponding to the two different types of orientation. Now, if you look at the shadow of the helicoidal surface which is bounded, you will see on your screen a peculiar type of eight loop, which I will call the analemma. So we need to understand the architectonic significance now of this pattern, what it says. Where I want to go by this is that I want to qualify the architectonic distinction, what in my view makes possible digital architectonics, in terms of the inside-outside distinction. In this picture here, first of all, observe that the different quanta, as we have called, they have length 2 pi jot. And the phase difference now between the red and the blue, which are mirror image reflections of each other, they differ in phase by pi. So we have now a qualification of the pi in terms of the harmonics of this helical standing wave. So we do not see the pi only from the perspective of the irrational or transcendental characterization of the perimeter and the area of the circle, which is what we see in geometry, but we see it now as a phase difference between the red and the blue mirror images or chiral images of this helical standing wave. So we have a harmonic now grasping of the number pi, which is very important to grasp what our universal equation of ciphers is. We need to recall one more point. How we think in quantum terms, in something which is already implicit, as we have explained, in the Pythagorean theory. How we think of the imaginary plane, of the complex plane, such that on the horizontal axis you have the real numbers, and on the vertical axis, you have the imaginary numbers. So we have not considered it as a representation, as an analytic Cartesian representation of a geometric construction. But we have uplifted the whole thing to the domain of harmonics, and our setting is basically mechanical, because we thought in terms of this Pythagorean orthogonal triangle, such that here on the real axis we qualify positions, and on the vertical axis we qualify velocities. So the whole issue is that in quantum space, which has to be expressed in terms of the complex numbers, we have not only positions, but we have also velocities, and we have to consider both of them separately and how they interact together. Recall now that this is related on the way that we have set up our calculus by integrated the viewpoints of Leibniz and Newton, and of course in relation always with the Pythagorean theorem, which permeates the differential and integral setting. The whole idea is very simple, that the velocity, and we think in terms of a uniform velocity, is tangent. So it's a kind of differential at this point here. And for each point, we have at the same time a translation of the velocity along the circumference of this small circle, which is defined by positions. But we have also a rotation. And the fundamental abstraction is that translation does not affect at all the rate of accumulating area in terms of these velocities. So these velocities, as they translate and rotate, they sweep out area. This is the area of this annulus here. So the whole issue now, where the harmonics comes in, and essentially the mechanics, is that all these velocities, since translation does not affect the rate of accumulating area through rotation, essentially all area is swept out because of rotation. If we had only translation, no area would be swept out whatsoever. We can harmonically transport all the velocities in the center. So if we transport all the velocities to the center, all these velocities will be distributed uniformly around the center of the circle, sweeping out some area, which is the area of a disk. But now this disk is the disk in momentum space. Okay? So this is the setting of the annulus here and how it can be perceived in terms of positions and tangent velocities, giving rise to an annulus, and in terms correspondingly of harmonically parallel transporting all these velocities to the center, which we have called center of synchronization, such that their lengths sweep out the whole area of this disk. So in this way, the area of the annulus, which is the content of the Pythagorean theorem, the area of this annulus is equal to the area of a disk which has radius this velocity here. And of course, as we said, that the velocity is not changing, so we have a uniform distribution. So what we get in momentum space is a disk, and the area of the disk is swept out by these velocities. Now, if we think, and this is the proper setting to think of it, as the complex plane, what we get is that the imaginary axis, here the imaginary axis, is the axis of velocities. Is the axis of velocities. In this way, now what happens is the following. That since all these velocities are uniformly distributed in a disk, their total, their average in terms of direction is zero. Okay? So, you can see that if we transport all these velocities to the center, they will densely be distributed uniformly around it. So basically we have a uniform probability distribution of velocities whose average, so in terms of direction, is zero. But there is an accumulated magnitude, which is the area that they sweep out. But the area is a positive real number. So in terms now of the imaginaries in the complex plane, what this says is that an imaginary rotation preserves all the area which is accumulated by the transport of these velocities to the center. So an imaginary rotation preserves all this area. And because of synchronization, now, this area can be considered as the magnitude of an imaginary translation along the imaginary axis. So if we think of the imaginary rotation preserving area as corresponding to the domain of architecture, which is exactly the tempering of area all around a center of synchronization, we get the bridge to mechanics through the relation between area and translation by the mechanical, actually quantum mechanical, imaginary translation to the center with magnitude having this area. In this way, we see that the relation between architecture through this perspective of tempering and synchronizing and mechanics is based on this subtle relation between translation and rotation, but now qualified in terms of the complex structure, so the structure which is given by the imaginaries on our screen. So an imaginary rotation is transcribed to imaginary translation of the center of synchronization with magnitude equal to the area, which is accumulated, of course, by these velocities. Let's now try to summarize all these findings from the perspective of natural communication. Let me make a simple comment what we have achieved here. Three things. The first thing is that this setting of the universal covering, dealing with the issue of both multiple connectivity and continuity, allows us to think of the exponential function as a projection of the helix, which is the real line in quantum space, onto the circle on our screen. And through this, we provided an extremely simple abductive proof of the fundamental theorem of algebra. The second point is the point which pertains to the double orientability. Still, we have to make sense of it in terms of architecture, geometrically, in terms of form. We will reach this point so that we want to see this peculiar number 8 figures that we get as shadows on our screen. But we think of the helicoid not as an operational geometric object, but in terms of a helical standing wave, which is caused by the self-interference between one type of unfolding with respect to one orientation and its mirror image, which of course on our complex screen is the fact that the introduction of the complex structure by the imaginary unit comes always together with a conjugate, what we call the complex conjugate. And it's the multiplication basically of these two, so it's the product, the synthesis, or the composition of these two, which allows us to grasp what's going on our screen endowed with a complex structure. And recall from the previous time that the exponential projection is conformal. Conformal means that this preserves angles. So every angle we get on the helix or on the helicoid, on the double helix of the helicoid, is preserved on our screen. So from our screen, we can completely reason about angles. All the angles are preserved. And the third point is again what we have grasped through our reading of the Pythagorean theorem, and of course the interpretation of this theorem now in terms of the complex plane, so our screen adorned with a complex structure or the conformal structure, which allowed us to express the relation between architecture thought in terms of distribution of area in space through imaginary rotations, and mechanics in terms of the imaginary translation of the center of synchronization along the imaginary axis. This relation would not be possible without the sub-relation between rotation and translation in terms of area, in terms of area which is swept out. So let's try to summarize the obstacle here is this idea of synchronization. We have to think abstractly in our setting what synchronization is actually about. And for this, we need, of course, an encoding bridge, which, as we explained previously, is expressed through translation and rotation of tangents, so of velocities. So we need, if we want to think in terms of synchronization, we need to think in terms of the momentum or velocity space, not only the position space. This immediately makes the issue of synchronization impossible to be grasped in classical space. So we need the real line as a helix in quantum space in order to figure out precisely and abstractly through this encoding bridge what we're talking about. So this qualification now led to the notion of area in geometry. So we have a partition spectrum of areas which are qualified in terms of this constant pi, this transcendental pi, which characterizes both the perimeter and the area, if we think in terms of circle, but also pertains to all conic sections. You see that this bridge leads to the notion of area which is enclosed or accumulated or swept out by tangents. So area is accumulated always in terms of tangents through rotation and transferred mechanically through translation. So we have a Pythagorean spectrum of areas. This is our partition spectrum. And our partition spectrum is characterized in terms of pi. This is the level of geometry. Now we need the inverse, the decoding bridge, to go back and to embrace the issue of synchronization. So in this way, to resolve what synchronization is about. And of course, as we have already seen, we can harmonically parallel transport all these tangents to a center of synchronization, which is the harmonic now center of synchronization. And in this way, not only we find the area, but also we end up from this picture here of the universal covering to what we have called the universal equation of ciphers. So, in terms of our screen, again, what it says is that the exponential, which is the projection now from the real line in quantum space to the circle, the exponential starts with the imaginary unit. For every complete rotation to pi, where now 2 pi j corresponds to a length of a quantum, times the winding number, so how many times we circulate, should equal the unity in the world of the circle. Which is the world of the circle? The circle is characterized through the faces, which are the values of the exponential function defined to this on the circle. And as we said, this world now is not a numerical world, but it has algebraic structure. It has the algebraic structure of the faces. So the faces on the circle, they are multiplied, and this multiplication can be performed in the circle. So the circle is closed, of course, with respect to multiplication of the faces. And since the multiplication of two exponentials equals to the exponential which has a power, the sum of these exponentials, we get, in terms of faces, the addition in terms of the angles. So let's come back now to think a little bit what this equation is about, what is really saying, and why is this equation, this universal equation of ciphers, which of course has to be considered together, since the whole thing makes sense on our complex screen, so our screen as the complex plane, so bearing the imaginary structure, has to be complemented with what is called Euler equation, which very simply it says that the exponential of pi j, so corresponding to a rotation by angle pi, equals minus 1. So it shows the path from unity to the opposite of unity. What is the important thing now is that you see that, first of all, 2 pi j is the length corresponding to one quantum. K is the winding number. Of course, we can think of the winding number in terms of the harmonic frequencies, integers. They are invariants. Now, what is the role of this universal constant, this transcendental pi, which characterizes our Pythagorean spectrum of areas? What harmonic parallel transport gives, thought of in terms of tempering uniformly around the center of synchronization area, is that this constant here, what it gives is a fine tuning between geometry expressed in terms of areas and harmonics expressed in terms of synchronization of tangents, so of velocities, sweeping out this area. So I would like to think of this pi not only as an irrational or transcendental number, which of course is algebraically, although it's not the solution of any algebraic equation. This is why it is transcendental. But I do not want to think of it ontologically, so to think of it in substantial terms. I want to think of it as playing a role of tuning now between areas that we get in the domain of geometry and architecture and this cipher here, which is the cipher which characterizes our synchronization in harmonics, but also in mechanics. Because we think of an imaginary rotation in terms of an imaginary translation of the center of synchronization. So here we have the length of the quanta, but this length of the quanta, which is what makes the real line in quantum space, comes out of a tuning which pertains to areas in architecture. So it is tuning these areas such that they comply to this universal equation of ciphers, of course, in terms of the winding number. And it is this tuning now, this irrational tuning, which makes synchronization possible. Now, this tuning is what makes possible both the uniform probability distribution, so dispersing the undisclosed geometrically center of synchronization, geometrically the origin of a circle which does not belong to the circle. So it is this pi which is tempering our scale, and it is this now which makes possible the characterization of areas in the real domain through colors. Because if you remember, the equally tempered scale, which comes now out of this tuning, is a chromatic scale. So we can think of areas in terms of colors. And these areas in the real domain have been qualified as areas under the hyperbola, which is an expression of the uncertainty principle. So this tempering is basically a quantum tempering. So it pertains to a quantum probability distribution. It shows how geometric areas are tuned together in terms of this constant pi as a tuning parameter, such that to obtain synchronization expressed mechanically as imaginary translation of the center of synchronization in terms of quanta having length 2 pi I. In this way, we understand both why we need the imaginary unit, why we need the winding number, which is the transcription of frequencies in our topological universal covering helix, and that pi is the unique real number, because pi is a real number, which achieves this tuning, such that what is inside the exponential gets the value 1, where the 1 is the unity in the harmonic domain. So this I find a very good way to think of what this constant is about, not as a substance, but in the communicational terms. So in this bidirectional domain of communication between harmonics and geometry. Here in this domain, where you have the spectrum of area, here is where architecture also takes place, but you cannot think of this geometry irrespectively of the communication with the domain of harmonics. Because if you think irrespectively, so you think of a circle which is characterized by this constant here, any circle, you cannot figure out that this is a constant of communication. This is not something which is given substantially for the geometric domain. Otherwise, we cannot grasp this transition from the rational domain of proportionality, what we got through the gnomon, how we get geometrically, not algebraically, the transition to a domain of areas which are expressed in terms of this irrational constant. The only way that we can make sense of this constant is if we follow this decoding bridge and we go back to the level of harmonics, where we end up with this universal equation of ciphers, which basically resolves the issue of synchronization.